Okay, assalamualaikum and good morning. Right. Today we will continue with lecture 7. And so for this topic, I think I have to conduct the class using this Google Meet so that you will get a better understanding on how to calculate the IBS score. Alright. So I've prepared all the related materials for this topic, including the slide, the manual in order to calculate the IBS score as well that has been uploaded in the UFU chat. Right. So far we have 41, excluding myself. Alright. So I think both classes should be 53 or 54. Good. Right, so I'm not sure why around 14, 15 students didn't join the session. All right, so we already started late, 8:45, because as in the timetable, we should start at 8. So I give you ample times, about half an hour, 8:30, to set yourself to join the class, but still. Some of you maybe have a problem with internet, I don't know. Okay, but never mind. We will start the session. I couldn't wait anymore. Okay, can you see my slide?
Yes,
Doctor. All right. So, before we focus on IBS content scoring system or how you can calculate the IBS score, I will touch a little bit on modular coordination. Okay? Because modular coordination and IBS is quite interrelated. Okay, it should work together. Okay, when you want to use IBS, you need to apply modular coordination as well. All right. So for the first part of today's lecture, we are going to focus on the modular coordination, and after that, we are going to move on to the IBS content scoring system. All right. So we begin our lecture with the first part or first topic. Which is on modular coordination. Okay, so this is the outline for the topic of modular coordination. Okay, I will give you introduction on what is modular coordination, especially on the definition. Okay, what modular coordination can do to our construction projects, and then we are going to have a look on the basic of module on how we can apply modular coordination in the in the construction projects, and one of the important information about modular coordination is about positioning of components and space. Okay. All right. For the introduction, okay, before we go into how we can define modular coordination, here a little bit of evaluation of measurement unit system. Okay, so based on this. Evolution of or in based on this table, we can say that actually modular coordination is about a dimensional system that we apply in the details drawings in manufacturing the IBS component. Okay, so basically this MC should be employed by the manufacturer in designing the IBS. Okay, so that's in general what's modular coordination all about. Okay, so as you can see in this table, this is a little bit of evaluation that has been done in measurement of unit system. Okay, so it started from using fingers. Okay. So then we're using lingkar, jengkal lima jari, right, tiga jengkal, lima jengkal, ten jengkal, right, so is, I think is perhaps oldest before we independent. Okay, then we are using hasta, and then after that we are using depa, right, and then we are using imperial system using inch, okay, quarter inch, 2 inch, etc. And then before we have MC or modular coronation, we are using metric system in mm, okay, millimeter. That's the detail. That's the measurement unit system that you have seen in the detail drawings of the construction projects. Okay, so starting from using fingers until lah using mm. Okay, so nowadays we improvise it by introducing what we call it as a modular coordination. So what is modular coordination actually? Okay, so modular coordination is a concept of coordination of dimension and space. Okay, in which buildings and component are dimension and position in terms of basic unit or module. Okay, we are using basic unit, basic unit and also module. Okay, in applying this modular coordination. Okay, so and it is internationally accepted by the ISO and many other countries including Malaysia lah. Okay, so actually this modular coordination is not only being used in Malaysia, but it's widely used around the world. And even it's being approved or accepted by ISO, okay, International Standard Organization. Okay, so what modular coordination can do to our construction project or to our construction project itself lah. Okay, firstly, it can improve productivity. Okay, so the productivity is very important in the construction projects. Okay, whereby the more productive your project is, the more profit you can get, because productivity is related to the level of profit. Okay, so productivity covers a lot of aspect of your construction projects, including the way you manage your project, the way you run the activities involved in your construction project. If you can run your project efficiently and smoothly, indirectly you will influence or indirectly you will improve the level of productivity, and at the same time you will improve the level of profit in your from your construction project. Alright, how modular coordination can improve the productivity is by through standardization. Okay, because you need to remember that you need to put in mind that when you apply IBS in your construction project, it's all about standardization and also simplicity. Okay, you are going to standardize a lot of things in terms of sizing, in terms of construction method. Okay, you are going to make it simple. Okay, that's what we call it, simplicity in terms of the component that are going to be produced is quite simple. It's very easy to be built and so on. Okay, so that's IBS all about. And when you integrate modular coordination in your detailed drawing, then it's much easier for you to achieve standardization and so simplicity. Okay. Alright, so again, as I mentioned earlier, is promote industrialization, component manufactured in factory. So means that modular coordination are very critical component when you're talking about implementing IBS. It means that when you want to implement IBS, you need to use MC in your detail drawing. So that the main objective of using IBS will be achieved. Okay, whereby you are talking about standardization, you are talking about simplicity. Alright, so again, as IBS and modular coordination are correlated, so you are going to involve less work on site, less wet work on site. So means that you are going to reduce the dependency on unskilled labor. Okay, so less modification on site also. So when we are talking less modification, you're going to create less wastage on site as well. So again, whatever you're going to achieve, whatever the benefits that you're going to get when you implement IBS in your construction project, same goes when you apply modular coordination in the detailed drawings of IBS component as well. Okay. So again, modular coordination is about dimension. Okay. So in order to have a standardized dimension, standardized sizing, modular coordination actually has been enforced in UBBL, okay, Uniform Building Bylaw in 2010. So means that when we were talking about enforcement, so it means that every detailed drawings that are being used in our country should implement or should use modular coordination. Okay, so sepatutnya drawing yang kita ada kat Malaysia ni dah pakai modular coordination. Okay, so by enforcing the modular coordination in UBBL, the government introduced what we call it as a Malaysian standard 1064. Okay, so here they are going, they include the guide to modular coordination in buildings. Okay, guide to modular coordination in buildings. So means that they specify sizing of your component. Okay, what size you can use for these 10 items. Okay. Right, this is the details lah. Okay, the most important things is about the coordinating sizes of stairs, window, door, okay, size for tiles, okay, size for bricks and block, okay, cabinets, right? So other things as well, like beams, okay, reinforced concrete ni is about beam, column, slab, right? They have included the standard size that you should apply in your detailed drawings using this Malaysian standard. If you follow this standard size, indirectly the main objective of using IBF will be achieved. Okay. Alright, so that's a little bit background of modular coordination. Next, we are going to talk about the basic model. Okay, so what type of model will be used when you apply modular coordination? Okay, the basic model is known as 1M, which is equivalent to 100mm. Okay, 1M equivalent to 100mm. Okay, so this is the, I can say, this is the basic of modular ni, I can say the rule of thumb when you implement modular coordination. Okay, inilah sizing yang you perlu pakai. 1M equals to 100mm. So, yeah, every sizing must be in this range, okay, 100mm. Okay, so you cannot create something like sizing yang ada 113 ke 114 ke. So based on this, okay, you have to design, for example, the wall. Okay, the wall must be within this range. Okay, maybe you want to develop a wall of 5100mm. Okay, so still you're using 1m. Okay, so means that 1m times 51. Okay, so kalau dinding you 5150, you will not achieve the mm punya objektif lah. Modular coordination punya objektif. Sebab dia guna this basic of module. Dia punya range of sizing is 100mm. Okay, so there are three types of module. Okay, the first type is basic module. Okay, so basic module, you're using this one lah, 100mm. Equals to 1m. Okay, so we are using another type of module that we have is multi-module. Okay, is a numeric prefix 2m, 3m, 4m. Okay, maksudnya 2m ni 200mm, 3m ni 300mm, 4m is 400mm. And we also have a sub-module. Okay, 1 divided by 5mm. So maksudnya 1 per 5 kali 100, maksudnya 20mm lah. Okay, this is what we call it as a fractional prefix. Okay, So this is what we call it as a fractional prefix dalam bentuk pecahan. Okay, ataupun dia boleh bentuk numerics. Okay, so there are three basic, three types of module lah. The one is the basic one. Okay, we have multi-module or we have sub-module. So here's some example. Okay. So you can state in your drawing using 300mm ataupun you boleh tulis dalam bentuk 3M. So kalau you using modular coordination, you send it to the manufacturer that they are going to produce the components, they will understand your drawing. Okay, so you give this one in your detail drawing, you masukkan 3M ni, 4x3 sebagai they will understand. Oh, they want panjang kolom 1.2 meter, 1200mm. Okay, so that's what we call it as a metric system to modular size. Alright, here's some of the things that you need to know. Okay, when you want to read the detailed drawings, whether you want to know whether that drawing is using modular coordination or not. Okay, so when the drawing, if the drawing using modular coordination as their dimensional system, they are going to use this icon, bulat. Okay, ini maksudnya this is a modular size. Okay, inilah sizing yang ikut Malaysian standard tadi, 1064. Okay, so kalau dia guna separuh saja, okay, maksudnya yang ini saja, this section only is a modular section. Okay, while this side is non-modular, means that this side is not using a modular sizing. Okay, so if you is a circle, full circle like this, both side are modular. Okay, maksudnya kedua-dua side, kat sini modular, kat sini pun modular. Okay, tapi kalau sebelah saja, okay, yang kat sini saja modular, yang belah sini tidak modular. Alright, that's how you can understand the drawing by looking at the icon used in the drawing. Okay. Alright, the last part of modular coordination that you need to know is about the positioning of component and space. Okay, so basically there are four types of positioning system, okay, which are boundary, axial, interaxial and flush reference system. Okay, so it's also known as a grid line. Okay, which normally been seen in the drawing specification or in the drawing details. Okay, yang kita biasa nampak dalam drawing. Okay, so the first one, we have a boundary reference. Okay, so as you can see, this is a boundary reference of or boundary grid. Okay, in your detailed drawing. Okay, second one, we have second one is axial reference. Okay, so as you can see, the different is they are putting the grid line in the middle. Okay, so they are putting the grid line in the middle. That's the different. And then we have interaxial reference. Okay, the different is that, okay, they are combining both boundary and also axial reference. Axial reference, as you can see here. And the last one, we have flush reference system. Okay, so their sizing is not that detailed. Okay, they give a big sizes lah when you're using flush reference. But based on these four types of positioning of component and space, normally in Malaysia we are using the first one, boundary reference. Okay, ini yang biasa digunakan pakai di Malaysia, boundary reference. Okay, dalam detail drawing kat Malaysia usually we are using boundary reference. Okay, so that's the main things that you need to know about modular coordination. Okay, so the main thing you need to know is that modular dimension is about the dimensional system that will be used in the detailed drawings for IBS manufacturer. Okay, in order to buy IBS for manufacturer to produce the IBS component. Okay, and the sizing or the dimension is based on 1M rules. Okay, 1M equals to 100 mm. Okay, so next, we are going to move to the second part, which is the main focus of today's lecture. Okay, because this topic is very important for you. Okay, because one of the reason why it is important, because it's one of the tasks that you need to do for your assignment. Okay, you need to calculate the IBS score for your proposed project. Okay, so this knowledge, is very important for your assignment as well as for your future. Okay. Hari ni. Bosmu. Okay. Why it is important for your future? Because later on, I think that in the future, this IBS content scoring system will be made compulsory in Malaysia. So every project need to submit the IBS scoring system before they can get approval. Okay, in future, I'm not sure when, but I believe in future the CIDB will go for it. Okay, so that's why I say it is important for you, for your future when you are working. Perhaps when you have a little bit of knowledge on IBS score, you could have your companies to calculate the IBS content scoring system lah. Okay, so what we are going to go through on this topic, firstly, I will brief you a little bit on the concept of viewability. Okay, before we go into detail about IBS score, okay, which cover about the objective, the principle of IBS score, okay, the content, okay, what you need to know before you can start calculating the IBS score. Alright, then I'm going to show you two examples on how we can apply the IBS score. Alright, then the last part of this topic, I'm going to share with you on how Singapore has done in successfully implementing the viewability concept or IBS itself lah. Okay, kita akan tengok. But most of the action taken by the government or by the CIDB is similar to what have been done in Singapore. Okay, lebih kurang sama. Alright, so that's why it's good for you to be exposed to what have been done in Singapore. Alright, before we go into the details about IBS score, let's see what is the meaning of concept of viewability. Okay, so before we go into detail, what is the concept of viewability? Why at the first place the concept of viewability come into the picture of construction project or construction industry? Macam mana boleh datang the concept viewability ni? Okay, the issue here usually design details are sometimes very difficult and even impossible to construct. Okay, siapa yang buat design? The designer, including architect. Of course, the architect is the main one lah, the main organization or the main parties involved during the design stage. Okay, they are going to design whatever they want. Okay, without considering the problems that the contractor will face on site. Okay. So architect will design whatever they want, okay, using their imagination, okay, without considering sama ada apa yang dia design tu boleh dilaksanakan atau tak, apa masalah yang contractor face on site atau tak, dia tak consider langsung. Okay, apa yang dia tahu, apa yang dia design on the piece of paper will be translate into reality. Okay, why this issue happen? Because there is a fragmentation between design and also construction practitioner. Ada pengasingan. Pengasingan ni maksudnya diorang ni, design and also contractor, dipisahkan dengan contract. Okay, if you are talking about design and build, tak ada masalah. Okay, nanti you akan belajar procurement. I'm not sure semester bila subject. Syllabus baru ni saya tak ingat lagi. Okay, tak boleh hafal lagi bila you akan belajar about procurement. But you will learn about procurement method. Okay, we have open tender, selective tender. Kita ada traditional method of procurement. Kita ada design and build. Kita ada tangki. Alright, benda tu you akan belajar. Okay, tapi kalau you guna traditional method of procurement, kita these two design and also contractor ni terpisah dengan contract. So means that they cannot have a direct communication. Okay, so dia tak boleh ada direct communication semasa design stage. Okay, masuk direct communication tu maksudnya contractor ataupun design architect boleh tanya contractor, okay, kalau aku design macam ni kau boleh buat tak? Dia tak boleh buat macam tu sebab dia terpisah oleh contract. Kita tak tahu lagi siapa contractor yang akan dilantik. Alright, so that's the issue. Alright, so in order to solve the issues means that in order to create indirect communication, so maksudnya akan ada apa yang dihasilkan oleh architect ni taklah too difficult to be constructed, to be built, okay, by the contractors. Okay, so in order to solve these issues, that's come into place the idea of concept of buildability. Okay, so itu datangnya idea concept of buildability ni. Okay, nak mengatasi masalah fragmentation ni. Tak ada direct communication ni. Okay, so what is buildability actually? Buildability is a share of responsibility. Share of the responsibility of all disciplines who constitute the multidisciplinary building team, including architect, engineer, surveyor, building contractor, subcontractors, and not the individual responsibility of the architect, okay, given by Griffith 1994. So means that everybody involved in the construction projects, when we are talking about the concept of buildability, they must realize that they must share the responsibility. Okay, so maksudnya architect bukan tugas dia hanya design saja, dia perlu tahu pasal construction, okay, dia perlu tahu pasal cost. Itu yang dimasukkan dengan buildability. Okay, or in other words, buildability also can be defined as the ability to construct a building efficiently, economically, and to agreed quality level from its constituent material, component and sub-assemblies. Dalam erti kata lain, nak make sure that we can achieve the concept of buildability, dalam erti kata lain, kita kena gunakan IBS. Okay, so itu yang dimasukkan dengan concept of buildability. When you use IBS, indirectly, you will integrate the concept of buildability in your construction project. Okay, you're going to solve this issue. Okay, so how we can solve the issues is by considering these principles of buildability. Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, these two organizations are the main components of construction project. Designer, which architect, constructor, which are the contractors. Okay, so again, these two entities has been separated by contract so that we cannot have a direct communication between these two sebab dia ada contract, kecuali kita guna design and build. As I mentioned earlier, design and build, they can have a direct communication, but if you're using turnkey, you're using traditional method of construction, we cannot have a direct communication between designers and constructor ataupun contractors, okay, sebab dia dipisahkan oleh contract. So macam mana kita nak make sure there is a direct communication, indirect communication between designer and also constructor atau contractors. Walaupun dia dipisahkan dengan contract, tapi kita nak make sure whatever design by the architect can be completed by the contractor without many problems. Okay, so nak make sure tu this designer must apply these four principles, which include function and performance, buildability itself, aesthetic and cost. So they need to design something that has a function and performance. Okay, dia tak boleh lagi design something that only have the aesthetic value saja. Okay, dia kena ada design yang ada function and then boleh perform. Okay, so kita tak nak design, kenapa you design macam ni? Sebab cantik. Tak boleh sebab cantik saja. Dia kena ada function, ada sebab. Okay, so that's benda yang designer kena consider. Okay, of course, buildability concept dia. Okay, dia kena ada responsibility. Alright, they need to consider IBS here. Okay, And of course, element of aesthetic need to be considered, okay, because of course, architect memang tak boleh lari from the aesthetic value. And the good thing about principles of buildability is that the designers must consider the aspect of cost. Okay, so sebelum ni dia tak consider sangat cost. Okay, they just design whatever they want, okay, without considering the cost. But nowadays they need to consider about the cost, okay, so that they can produce something, design something that within the cost. Okay, alright. So when the design or designer design something that follow these four principles, then they appoint the contractors, and then the contractors need to complete the design based on these three principles, okay, which is agreed quality level. So means that the contractor need to follow the drawing specification. If the drawing asks you or the details ask you to use concrete grade 30, use the grade 30, don't lower the grade. Okay, again, kena, kalau pakai ABS, pakailah ABS, buildability. Alright, and they need to complete the design within the cost. Okay, tak mahu lebih. Okay, less or equal the cost lah. Alright, so that's the principles of buildability. Alright, the next thing about buildability is about the design characteristic. Okay, okay, the design characteristic of buildability, they are talking about the 3S concept. The first S is standardization. Okay, so again, it work well with IBS because IBS is all about standardized. Okay, repetition of grid, sizes of component, connection details. Okay, so these things can be repeated, can be standardized. Alright, the second S is simplicity. Okay, uncomplicated building construction system and simple installation. Alright, there's some of the example how you can create the element of simplicity in your design by using IBS. And the last one is, the last S is single integrated system. Okay, elements that combine components together. Okay, so for example, like kita ada, masa I give you lecture on precast, we have a toilet unit. Okay, prefab toilet unit, satu toilet unit yang kita dah siap pasang tile, pasang bathtub dan sebagainya, piping semua dan sebagainya. Itu dipanggil single integrated system. Kita combine, siap-siap dekat kilang, hantar kat site tu pasang. Okay, yeah, that's what we call it, a single integrated system. So we need to create a lot of single integrated system in your construction project. Okay, so that you can achieve the concept of buildability. So beside that, the key features of buildability design include usage of component. Okay, as again, MC, okay, standardized again, repeated structural grid. Okay, grid layout dalam drawing kita, vertically 100%, horizontally at least 60%. Okay, column and beam group to few sizes. Okay, repeated. Okay, rough foundation, system toilet, precast staircase, standard modules, windows and doors. Okay. Alright, some of the examples about unbuildable versus buildable in this slide is I'm going to share about the structural system. Okay, so here the first four pictures here is describe the environment when you're using unbuildable system of your structural system. Okay, remember structure kita adalah column, beam and slab. Okay, so so here are the examples of an unbuildable system. Means that when you're using traditional method of construction, okay, conventional method of construction, you boleh tengok you punya site condition macam mana, it's very messy and so on. Okay, if you're using buildable structural system, okay, kalau you gunakan precast for example here, okay, you punya site lebih cleaner, okay, lebih nampak bersih, alright, because less work, concrete work on site. Okay, this example of flat plate, kita ada precast slab, precast beam. Okay, yang ini kita integrate precast column dengan beam, kita pasang siap-siap dekat kilang, and then sampai kat set gitu, pasang kat tempatnya. Okay, and we have also beautiful system using steel. In steel construction is one of the example of beautiful system. Okay, we are using formwork system, okay, which is part of IDS. Right, using one of the example also that apply beautiful system in your construction project. Okay, and next we are talking about wall system. Okay, unbeatable versus beatable system. Okay, when we're talking about beatable system, we're talking about traditional brick wall. Okay, you lay bricks floor by floor. Okay, if you're talking about 30 story, you pakai batu-bata ni. Okay, berapa puluh ribu, berapa ratus ribu batu-bata diperlukan. Nak completekan 30 tingkat. Okay, berapa lama masa nak siap pula. Alright, time consuming. Lot of cost needed, lot of workers needed. Okay, when you are using traditional brick wall, but you, if you work, if you apply beautiful wall system, for example like using precast, okay, you will faster your construction time, and then you will reduce unskilled workers. Okay, so nowadays because of the lot of advancement in technology, okay, we can produce precast component with architectural finishes, as you can see here. Even you can color precast facade wall. Okay, dah siap color dekat kilang. Okay, you give any details to the manufacturer. Okay, nak color purple ke hijau ke whatever, then dia akan paint the wall for you on at the factory, then deliver to the site. Okay, and then we have precast facade wall lah, of course. And then we have a precast facade with aircon ledge. Alright, so that's some of the examples of beautiful wall system. And finally, we are talking about features. Okay, unbeatable versus beautiful features. Okay, features we are talking about bay window, staircase. Okay, this is the traditional way of constructing the staircase and bay windows. You can see you're using a lot of formworks, reinforcement bar, right? But if you are using beautiful features, okay, all of these features can be done at the, can be manufactured at the factory, delivered to the site. So even now we can produce balcony, okay, this is precast bay windows, of course staircase, boundary wall, meter chamber, semua boleh buat kat kilang. Alright, so that's how beautiful your design is when you're using IBS ataupun precast, whatever type of IBS that you want to use. Okay, alright, so that's modular coordination. Okay, ada soalan so far?
No, sir.
Tak ada, Doktor.
Okay, jangan tidur pula. Walaupun saya tak nampak you all. Alright, so the last part of today's lecture. Saya ada one time je. Tak ada, Doktor. Alright, the last part of today's lecture, we are going to cover the most important part of today's lecture lah. Okay, yang ni paling penting sekali hari ni. Yang awal-awal tadi just give you the connection. Okay, macam ni kita nak tahu IBS dan sebagainya. Alright, so we are going to learn about IBS Core. Okay, so of course it's a calculation. Okay, so today I am going to brief theoretically on what is the things that you need to know about IBS Core. And next week, we are going to do the exercises on IBS Core together. Okay, next week kita akan buat exercise bersama-sama using this mid session as well. Okay, so saya akan bagi few soalan and then kita akan buat sama-sama. So I am going to upload the question on the you feature. Okay, so perhaps maybe you, if you want to try it first, you boleh try dulu. Next week kita akan tengok macam mana. Okay, kita akan discuss the answer lah. I'm going to show you the step. Okay, before we go into detail about IBS Core, little bit history on IBS Core. Macam mana IBS Core ni boleh diperkenalkan, has been introduced by CIDB in Malaysia. Okay, as you know, as IBS has been introduced in Malaysia in the late 1960s. Okay, dah lama dah. 1960-an, IBS dia diperkenalkan di Malaysia. Okay. And then after that, in the late 1990s and early 2000, barulah government kita with the CRDB has decided that IBS is a way forward for our construction project, for our construction industry. So means that barulah kita getting serious. Yeah, a lot of initiatives taken, a lot of effort has been done by the government and CRDB in promoting the IBS starting from 1990s, early 2000. Okay. So as you can see, I think during the first lecture, I share with you that government introduced a circular whereby every government project need to use at least 70% of IBS. Okay, sebelum ni guna 30%, lepas tu naik 50%, sekarang ni 70%. Okay, means that every government project that more than 10 million should use at least 70% IBS. Okay, so dia dah ada regulation tu. But now, macam mana nak monitor? Macam mana kita nak tahu yang projek tu sebenarnya guna 70% at least? So that's come into place the manual on how to calculate the usage of IBS in your construction project, which is known as IBS Content Scoring System. Okay, itulah datangnya idea untuk create this manual, give a guideline for the construction players to use to calculate the usage of IBS score in the construction project. Okay, so sekarang ni dengan adanya manual ni, kontraktor tak boleh tipu lagi dah penggunaan IBS in their construction project. Okay, so kalau orang tanya berapa IBS score you? 80. Macam mana tahu? Assume je yang kan ni kolom pakai ni ni lah. Tak boleh dah. Sebab kita dah ada manual macam mana nak calculate. Okay, so this manual has been uploaded in YouTube. Okay, so this is the latest version 2018. Okay, of course kita menggunakan version yang baru 2018. Alright, so for your information, this manual or IBS score has been introduced in Malaysia. The first version is in April 2005. Sebenarnya dah diperkenalkan di Malaysia manual nak calculate IBS score ni 2005 yang pertama. And then after 10 years in 2010, CIDB revised it and introduced a second version. And then after 8 years, 2018, barulah dia revise, dia perkenalkan yang terbaru. So dah 3 version of IBS score. So we are using the latest one lah. Okay. Okay, that's a little bit history of IBS score. Dan apa dia punya objektif? I think I mentioned a little bit just now. Okay, to provide a well-structured assessment system. Okay, assessment system for the IBS score. Okay, so dia ada guideline dia macam nak calculate. Apa yang nak calculate? Okay, set out the IBS score formula, apa formula dia, apa IBS factor dia. I'm going to explain to you later on. Okay, methods of calculating. Okay, macam mana nak calculate, apa info yang you perlu tahu, sample calculation. Semua ada dalam manual tu tadi. And I dah extracted a little bit yang mana penting-penting saya masuk ke dalam nota ni lah. Okay. It's also intended to provide a complete guidance for every professional to evaluate the IBS score for any building project. Mana-mana building project boleh pakai this IBS score. Alright, nanti I'm going to show you the details. Okay, so that's the objective of IBS score. Alright, next you need to know is the principles of IBS score. Apa rules dia? Okay, sebelum you boleh apply IBS score in your construction project. Okay, sebelum ni ada 5 rules of or the principles of IBS score. But this latest version of 2018 dah tinggal 4 saja principles. Okay, yang pertama, usage of IBS component. Of course, you nak apply IBS score ni kena pakai IBS lah. Okay, if your project is not using IBS, okay, tak, it's not relevant lah to use IBS score. Okay. Okay. Ada yang saya tak approve ke? Kawan you, yep. Dah kurator Nur kurator ada.
Tadi doktor dah approve saja tapi kita tak ada dalam ni.
Ya. Ke WhatsApp saya ni. Sudah suruh dia join di sini. Right, never mind. Okay, so that's the first principles. Okay, you need to use IBS in your construction project so that you can use IBS Corp. Second one, utilization of standardized component based on Malaysian Standard 1064. So means that it means that you need to use modular coordination. Okay, dalam you punya dimensional system, sizing of your component. You need to use standardized component. Kena follow sizing that has been included in the Malaysian Standard 1064. Okay. You need to have a lot of repetition of structural layout. Okay, vertical and horizontal. Alright. And the last one, usage of other productivity enhancing solutions such as volumetric modular units, beam, again MC. Okay. So maksudnya yang ini yang why I highlighted it's in red because yang ini yang terbaru that has been included in the in this latest manual of IBS Corp 2018 dia masukkan yang ni yang baru. So dia nak galakkan orang gunakan volumetric modular units. Okay, if you have a look on your lecture 2 on precast concrete, okay, kita kena tengok volumetric ni dalam bentuk apa. Okay, macam staircase, toilet unit tadi. Okay, dia kena pakai beam untuk dapat skor yang tinggi. So kena integrate 3 komponen, MC, beam dengan IBS. Okay, 3 ni can work together actually. Tak ada masalah. Alright, so ada join ke ni? Request. Tak ada pun. Okay, so that's the first principle that you need to know about IBS. Okay, yang ni. Kena ada empat ni barulah you boleh apply IBS Corp in construction project. Okay, so as we mentioned before, this IBS Corp can be applied in every building, type of building, which include residential, okay, landed or non-landed, commercial building, industrial building, yang ini industrial building silap ni, tak tukar, lupa pula. Okay, yang ini, this one is industrial building. Okay, sorry. Institutional building, sorry. Institutional building. This one. Okay, institutional building for this one. Okay, so that's category of building. So it can be applied in any type of building. Tak ada limit to residential saja. Tak ada limit untuk commercial saja. So any type of building can use this manual. Okay, IBS Corp. Alright, so we are going to have a look on the content of scoring system. Okay, what you need to know. Okay, about the IBS before you can start calculating the IBS Corp. Okay, so there are 5 elements that you need to know about IBS Corp. Okay, the first one, the maximum score for a building is 100 points. For a building. Okay, saya tekan kat sini. For a building is 100 points. Maksudnya, means that if you have 3 building in your project, you have to calculate one by one. Satu bangunan satu. Bangunan A berapa IBS score dia? Bangunan B berapa IBS score dia? Bangunan C berapa IBS score dia? Okay, like your project, you have three towers. Okay, so each tower will have their own IBS score. Okay, so that's the first thing you need to know. Second one, the IBS score is made up of the following component or is made up on the 3 main component. Okay, ada 3. Alright, there are 3 main component. The first component is structural system. Okay, and the maximum score for the first part is 50 points. Okay, structural system include beam, column, okay, slab. Yes. Okay, yang membentuk kita punya structure. Second part is our wall system. Score dia adalah 20. Alright. And contoh-contoh wall, of course, precast panel, glass, dry partition, block work, etc. Okay, and the last part is other simplified construction solution. And maximum score dia adalah 30. Okay, ini contoh macam standard deck. Kat sini lah markah yang kita dapat kalau kita follow sizing on Malaysian Standard 1064. About repetition, beam. Kalau kita pakai precast staircase dan sebagainya, semua kat dalam ni markah dia. Nanti I'm going to show you. Okay, so weightage dia 50, 20, 30. Okay, weightage markah. Point ni. Total 100. Okay, ini yang being revised. I think masa 2005, masa first version of IBS score, if I'm not mistaken, weightage dia adalah 50, 40, 10 pada peringkat awal. Except saya. Ataupun 50, 30, 20. Dia punya weightage. Okay, sekarang dia dah change a little bit. Okay. So that's the second thing you need to know. Second element you need to know. First, 100 point dia adalah 100 for each building. And dia terbagi pada 3. Okay. Part 1, structural system. Part 2, wall system. And part 3, ada simplified construction solution. Weightage score dia 50, 20, 30. Okay, each component of IBS ni tadi, IBS score ni tadi, tiga ni tadi, structural, wall, and other simplified construction solution ni, dia ada what we call it as a reference table. Okay, why they need the reference table? You know, they need the reference table in order to identify the IBS factor. I'm going to go to IBS factor later on. Okay, so ini dia punya weightage. Okay, so among these three part, yang paling senang nak kira adalah table 3 atau part 3 ni. Okay, the direct point. Daripada table, you dah ambil point, you tambah terus lagi. Okay, part 1 and 2 ni ada little bit tricky lah. Okay, nanti saya tanya. Okay, what is IBS factor? Kalau you tengok kat sini, kita nak tahu IBS factor. What is IBS factor? IBS factor ni is derived from productivity studies done by CIDB. It is given to each building system. It means that more buildable system, higher factor, shorter construction time. So maksudnya makin banyak IBS you pakai, makin tinggi IBS factor dia. Okay, IBS factor ni is a value between 0 to 1. In between that je, within that je, 0 ke 1. Sama ada 0.8 ke 0.5 ke ataupun 1. Okay, so contoh kat sini. Contoh saya bagi scenario, macam mana you nak.
Hi, it's nice to meet you, Reza.
Okay, so example on how to determine your IBS factor. Okay, so here in this example, you are using full precast for your structural system. Beam pakai precast, column pakai precast, slab, plank pun pakai precast. So means that full precast, your IBS factor will be 1. 1 maximum. Nanti kan kejap lagi tripod. Satu lap speaker.
Apa tu? Tripod?
Kejap lagi. Kita turun bawah call. Pasal Zafri ke tak tanya. Okay. So when you're using full precast, your IBS factor will be 1. 1. Okay, macam mana dapat? Ini gunanya table yang saya bagikan ni. Alright. Table 1. Table 1 untuk IBS factor for structural system. Table 2 untuk wall system. And table 3 untuk other simplified construction solution. Okay, saya bagi contoh tadi. Structural system. Okay, dalam contoh semua precast dia pakai. Okay, beam, precast column, beam, dia pakai ni. Concrete, slab pun dia pakai precast. Okay, KIBS factor you satu, you dapat daripada table straight away. Okay, level map. I'm going to show you in details next week. Okay, on how to use this table. Okay. So, kalau you guna combination of precast and cast in situ. Okay, which is traditional method of construction. Okay, ada element of traditional in your construction method, in your structural system. Okay, maksudnya contoh kat sini, beam dengan column, you pakai traditional method, cast in situ concrete. You tengok pakai forward dan sebagainya. Hanya flooring system saja you pakai IBS. Okay, hollow core slab. Okay, maksudnya flooring system saja you pakai IBS. So, in this case, IBS factor you akan rendah, 0.6. Sebab ada element of traditional kat sini. Kat column dengan beam. Cuma dekat slab saja you pakai IBS. IBS factor you akan rendah. So makin banyak IBS makin banyak IBS you pakai, makin tinggi IBS factor you. Itu konsep dia lah. Okay, so never mind. Kalau belum nampak lagi, nanti kita akan tengok sama-sama later on lah dalam masa exercise nanti. InsyaAllah you akan dapat lebih faham. Okay, ini contoh kalau you pakai steel construction. Okay, semua steel, flooring you pakai steel, column beam pakai steel, IBS you satu. But it's a full precast. Okay, yang ketiga is formula dia. Okay, tadi kita dah tengok dia punya first tadi 100 markah untuk setiap bangunan or building terbagi kepada tiga komponen. Okay, structural, wall dengan ada simplified construction solution. Weightage dia 50, 20, 30. Okay, next you need to know is about the formula. Okay, means formula dia you kena kira part by part. That means that part 1 structure system you calculate dulu berapa, then you calculate part 2 berapa and part 3 berapa, then you total up. Okay, then you akan dapat you punya base score. And this is the formula. Jangan risau, nampak macam complicated. Okay, sebenarnya tak susah mana pun. Okay, to be honest, tak susah mana pun nak calculate base score. Jangan risau. Okay, I'm going to brief to you later on lah. Okay, untuk formula ni, jangan risau. Okay, and the next element that you need to know about IBS score is that IBS score calculation consider superstructure only. Maksudnya, substructure work kita tak kira IBS score. Maksudnya untuk kerja-kerja basement, okay, you tak kira, kita tak kira. Kita cuma kira superstructure. Okay, daripada kolom yang dinaikkan di atas tanah tu dan ke atas. Yang mana bawah tanah, kita tak kira. Yang mana kita pijak, kita tak kira. Yang ke atas saja kita kira. Okay, that's super structure. And the last thing you need to know, in case of a group of building, in one project, the IBS score for the project shall be calculated by multiplying the percentage of area of the respective building. Okay, dia ada formula dia. Okay, untuk calculate IBS score for the whole project. Okay, tadi kita dah tahu IBS score, you kena calculate building by building. Okay, kalau macam projek yang you kena buat ni, ada 3 tower, you calculate tower A berapa skor dia, tower B berapa skor dia, tower C berapa skor dia. And then you kena calculate total IBS score for the whole project. Ada formula ni, and this is the formula. Ini pun kita akan buat exercise bersama-sama next week. Okay, jangan risau. So that's the first element that you need to know about IBS score. 5 benda ni you kena tahu. Okay, pertama tadi 100 untuk satu bangunan bagi kepada 3. Weightage dia 50, 20, 30. Formula dia cuma consider superstructure and formula untuk calculate the whole project. Okay? Ada soalan? Any question? Boleh? Okay, next kita tengok example. Okay, there are two example. First example is about the transformation project done by UEM. Okay, they want to transform their old automatic workshop into the UEM Academy and IBS Center. Okay, it's a two-story building. Okay, that's the detail of the project lah, dua bangunan, dua tingkat. Okay, first kita calculate part 1. Okay, First kita calculate ground floor. Okay, ini detail yang diberikan, maksudnya komponen yang pakai untuk structural system dia. Dia pakai pakai beam steel and column, and then slab dia pakai precast concrete. Okay, so first you can calculate construction area untuk ground floor. Okay, that's why saya suruh you buat floor plan. But you kena calculate area. Okay, in meter square. Alright, ini area untuk ground floor. IBS sector dapat daripada table 1 tadi. Okay, and then this okay, amount ni, 2213 ni. Yeah, you divide by total area. Okay, this is the total construction area. 6361, you akan dapat 0.34. Alright, next, you ambil 0.34 ni times IBS factor times 50. Why 50? Because the maximum score for structural system is 50 points. 50 markah. Okay, that's why you kena kali 50. Then you akan dapat 17 untuk ground floor. Repeat the same process untuk first floor. Dapat 12.5. Roof, you dapat 20. You total up. Part 1, score you adalah 49.5 out of 50. Okay. Ada dua cara you nak check you punya calculation. First, make sure total up coverage ni mesti dapat 1. 1. If you get less than 1 or more than 1, something wrong with your calculation. Okay. And second way that you can check your answer, make sure kat sini. 49.5 ni. Jawapan yang you dapat kat sini mestilah less or equal to 50. Kalau you dapat more than 50, 52 ke 51 ke, adalah kesilapan kiraan kat sini. Okay, so that's the way you can check your answer. Right? Second part is wall system. Okay, so wall, we have two types of wall. External and internal. Dinding luar dan dinding dalam. Okay, ini jenis-jenis dinding yang dia pakai untuk dinding dalam. Luar, external. Okay, digunakan precast concrete, metal cladding, full height glass, prefab timber panel. Okay, yang ini you kena kira parameter, length dia dalam meter. Okay, berapa panjang precast concrete block digunakan? Okay, dalam projek ni digunakan 108 meter panjang dia. Metal cladding digunakan 96 meter. Full height glass 152 meter. Prefab timber panel digunakan 24 meter. Okay, itu untuk internal, external wall. Internal wall pun dia pakai 4 jenis type of wall. Precast block, drywall, metal cladding and prefab timber panel. And this one dia punya length for internal wall. Then you total up, you dapat 1164. This is the total wall length. Ya, yeah, IBS factor ni you dapat daripada table 2. Okay, table 2 dia senang sikit. Okay, part 2 ni dah little bit easy. Okay, compare to part 1. Part 1 tu ada tricky sikit lah kakak. Okay, jangan risau. Nanti saya tunjuk more detail masa exercise nanti. Okay, sama konsep, ambil panjang precast ni, okay, times dengan total wall length, divide by total wall length, you dapat coverage. Then take this coverage 0.09 times IBS factor, and then you times 20. Sorry, ni patut 20. Okay, why 20? Because the maximum score for part 2 is 20. 20. You dapat 1.8 untuk sini, then repeat the same process, then you total up, you dapat 17.2. That's the IBS score for part 2. Again, sama, make sure kat sini kena 1, yang ini kena less or equals to 20. Alright, so that's how you calculate part 2. Alright, part 3, lagi senang lah calculate. Okay, you tengok ada tiga komponen of part 3, standardized component, repetition dengan other prefab component. Okay, ni komponen-komponen dia, beam, column, slab, door, windows, you tengok lah dalam detail berapa banyak size yang sama. Okay, katakan beam you, ada 100 batang beam dalam projek you. Daripada 100 tu berapa banyak size yang sama? So maybe 75 size yang sama. Okay, so maksudnya 75%. Okay, so this percentage. Okay, yang ini you boleh assume for your project lah. Okay, so you dapat daripada table score dia directly. Okay, as you can see dalam table ni. Table 3. Sebab tu table 3 ni kalau you tengok nama table dia dah adalah IBS Core. Compare to table 1 and 2. IBS Factor. IBS Factor. Okay, table 3 ni dia panggil dia IBS Core sebab dia direct point. Okay, kat sini kalau you tengok dia 2 markah dia. Okay. So, masukkan kat sini 2. Okay, kalau 4 lah. Alright. Then you total up, you dapat 15.5. Okay, kat sini maksimum dia 30. Alright. And then you total up, you dapat 92.7 for this project. For this first example, it's quite high lah score dia. Alright. So that's how you apply lah. Okay, never mind. Yang masih tak nampak lagi next week, masih kita buat exercise. Hopefully you get a better idea lah, a better understanding on how to calculate the IBS score. Second example is a high-rise project. Okay, tadi is just a two-story. Yang ini 18-story condominium. Okay, this is the details. Okay, construction area. Area for one unit of condominium 94.4 meter. Okay, kalau you tengok satu floor ada 6 unit. Okay, lift lobby dia area dia 140 meter square. Okay, so area for one floor 94.4 satu unit kali 6 unit tambah 140. So total area for satu floor adalah 706.4 meter square. Okay, so ini structural system yang dia pakai tunnel formwork, roof truss dia pakai prefab steel. Okay, wall system dia, internal wall dia pakai precast block work, satu jenis sahaja. Okay, so, previous example tadi dia banyak pakai jenis, pelbagai jenis, tapi dalam ni dia pakai satu jenis saja. Okay, internal wall dia pakai precast block work, panjang dia 25.2 meter. Okay, external wall dia pakai tunnel formwork, wall and lobby pun dia pakai tunnel formwork, 41.06 meter, 17.3. Ini details dia. Okay, window dengan door saja yang pakai size yang sama. 100% comply dengan Malaysian standard. Repetition of floor to floor height 90%. Vertical repetition structural floor layout 80%. Okay, untuk part 1 structural system. Okay, total area dia, kalau you tengok 18 tingkat, tak semestinya you nak kena calculate satu floor by floor. Sebab tu saya tekankan pasal standardization, standard size. Okay, ini maksudnya size dia sama setiap tingkat. 18 tingkat ni sama. So you kali je lah 706.4 meter square kali 18 tingkat terus. Okay, you akan dapat total 12. So tak adalah nak kena calculate satu-satu. Kalau setiap tingkat you berbeza size, itu you kena calculate lah. Kalau 30 tingkat, satu tingkat, first floor berapa size, second floor berapa size dia, area dia, sorry. Okay, so that's why IBS ni dia menggalakkan standardization supaya you senang. Okay, roof area you kena calculate separately lah. Okay, because roof area, okay, it's a different entity. Okay, so total up you dapat 13,000. Okay, so IBS factor sebab you pakai tunnel formwork, IBS factor dia kurang sikit. Okay, so this value 0.6 untuk dapat 0.95 ni 12,000 bahagi dengan 13,421 ni. You akan dapat 0.95. IBS score 0.6 kali 0.95 kali 50. Okay, you get 28.5. Then repeat the same process, total up, you akan dapat 31. The structural system. Again, must be equal or less than 50. Right? Wall system, dia pakai internal, pakai precast block work. Okay, satu unit 25.2 meter length yang diperlukan. Kita ada 6 unit and kita ada 18 tingkat. So total internal wall length adalah 2721.6. External wall, they are using tunnel for work. Okay, the length for each unit is 41.06. So times 6 times 18, you can dapat total. Wall and lobby, different area. Then you total up, you akan dapat 7,000 plus for the total of wall length. So and then you divide the IBS factor from the table 2. You repeat the same process, 0.36. Ni you dapat daripada this one times total area. Divide total area. Okay, so nak calculate IBS score, 0.36 times IBS factor times 50. Times 20. You akan dapat 3.6. So you total up, you akan dapat 11.6. Again, make sure less than or equals than 20. Alright? And then part 3, direct point from table 3, you get it, all this info from table 3, you get 12. And then you total up, you dapat 54.16 points for this second example. Okay, it's quite low lah. Okay, kalau government project, dia tak achieve the minimum requirement, which is 70%. Okay? So, ada tak lah? Bila kita masuk on the last part. Nah, ini ya just for your info saja. Okay, yang last part. Successful reduction of visibility concept in Singapore. Kalau tak ada, kita tengok little bit. Okay, ini just for your knowledge, kita tengok macam mana Singapore boleh berjaya menerapkan konsep of visibility. Nanti kata lain IBS lah. Okay, cuma kat Singapore, they are not calling IBS. They are not calling as an IBS. Okay, dia panggil prefect. Okay, prefect technique, pre-verification. Okay, benda sama. Cuma nama je berbeza. Okay, the concept of visibility is first introduced in Singapore in 1991. Okay, masa 1991 ni Singapore pun ada CIDB. Dia masih pakai CIDB. Okay, so then in 1991 ni CIDB of Singapore developed what we call it as a Visible Design Appraisal System, BDAS, which is a scoring system to measure the potential impact of visual design on the usage of site labor. A scoring system. So maksudnya BDAS ni dia sama macam kita punya IBS content scoring system. Okay, cuma nama dia berbeza. Okay, benda yang sama. Okay, so maksudnya kat sini, you tengok kat sini 1991 lagi dia orang bangunkan. Develop this BDAS. Okay, so then CIDB dia tukar nama kepada Building Control Authority, BCA. They promote this system and then they create awards competition nak bagi recognition to designers and also contractors, mana yang design cantik yang dapat skor tinggi, right, they give recognition, penghargaan. And then after 10 years, in 1 January 2001, they make it legislated. Maksudnya dia wajibkan dah this Visible Design Appraisal System. Okay, dia wajibkan this concept of visibility. Every construction project in Singapore must have minimum requirement to use visibility concept ataupun IBS in their country lah. Okay. Legislation dia, apa dia apply? Apply to all new residential, any project yang gross floor area dia 5,000 meter square and more. Okay. Setiap project yang gross floor area dia 5,000 meter square and more, kena apply this concept. Okay. So, extension works pun subjected to the requirement, kena juga follow. Okay, ada pengecualian, exempted, pengecualian untuk worship, masjid dan sebagainya, utility government punya yang ada confidential punya level, dia dikecualikan. And then, dia kena submit. Okay, apa membezakan kita dengan dia adalah, dia sama tapi ada perbezaan little bit adalah di mana, okay, they develop what we call it as a code of practice. Okay, kita, macam kita construction industry standard. Okay, as you can see kita punya buku ni nama dia CIS, as you can see, construction industry standard. Okay, construction industry standard. Okay, dekat Singapore they are using code of practice. Dia panggil code of practice. Okay, manual dia. Sama. Okay, buku dia. Alright. So, dalam manual dia, lebih kurang macam kita tu. Mesti lebih kurang macam kita punya CIS tadi. Cuma apa yang membezakan, diorang ada minimum visibility score. Ha, Ini yang kita tanya. Okay, yang lain semua sama. Okay, bukan sama 100% lah. Dia ada konsep dia, idea dia sama. Okay, cuma perbezaan dia, dia ada ni. Okay, dia pun terbagi kepada 3 part. Part 1, part 2, part 3. Okay, scoring dia pada peringkat awal adalah 50, 40, 10. Pada peringkat awal. Okay, sekarang ni dia ada perubahan. Nanti kita akan tengok. Pada peringkat awal 50, 40, 10. Okay, kenapa kat sini 10? Sebab orang Singapura tahu kat sini yang paling senang nak skor. You follow size dia, dia dah boleh dapat skor. Walaupun you tak pakai bias. Okay, sebab tu dia letak rendah. Okay. So kat Malaysia kita tahu kat sini skor senang, kita letak 30. Kita nak tolong ni. Orang kontraktor dan sebagainya untuk dapat skor yang tinggi. So kita letak tinggi kat sini. Alright. So apa membezakan kita adalah dia ada minimum ability score. Apa minimum ability score ni? Contoh dekat sini. Ni masa first version. Okay. Dia ada category of building. Residential, landed, non-landed. Kita fokus satu example je. Eh? Kita fokus residential, landed. Okay. Okay. Kalau you punya gross floor area 5,000 ke 25,000, you kena dapat score you 52. Kalau lebih daripada 25,000 meter square, you punya score kena 55. Minimum. So means that if your project, kalau kita nak start project, you need to submit the building plan. You kena submit for the authorities. Okay. So kalau you submit you punya score untuk project residential ni, you dapat, you submit dengan score you 40 saja, your plan will be rejected. Okay. So you kena revise balik sampailah you dapat at least 52 ni. Okay, ataupun lebih. Lebih baguslah. Ataupun at least 52. Ini pada tahun 2001. Okay, dia nak train supaya orang gunakan IBS dekat negara dia. Tapi tak adalah tinggi. Okay, dia start dengan 52 sahaja. Okay, rendah. Okay, ini pada 2001. Itu pun selepas 10 tahun. After 10 years of promoting IBS in their country. Okay. And then in 2005, they revise lagi. Okay, kalau tadi kena start 5,000. Okay, sekarang 2,000 meter square dah ada. Kena ada minimum score dia. Okay. So kalau kita tengok tadi, yang ini 5,000 start dengan 52. Tengok sekarang 5,000 dah naik ke 59. Kalau tadi kat sini 55, sekarang dah naik 62. Selepas lebih kurang 4 tahun. After 4 years. Right? So, in 2005, they introduced a new category, A&A, which is additional and alteration. Maksudnya untuk kerja-kerja renovation. Okay, untuk kerja-kerja renovation pun kena ada minimum score dia juga. You nak renovate rumah ke dan sebagainya, ada minimum score dia. Maksudnya, even you are doing renovation work, you still need to use IDS in Singapore. Okay? Right, so after that, they revise lagi 2007-2008. So ni cepat dia revise 2007, kalau tadi start 52, sekarang dah 62. 2008 tak sampai, after almost 1.5 years, dia revise lagi, naik jadi 65. Okay, so tadi kat sini starting 55, sekarang dah 68. Right. And then 2015, dia revise lagi, sekarang dah jadi 78, sekarang dah jadi 81. Start tadi dengan 52. And then in this 2015, dia revise scoring dia. Weightage dia dari 45, 45, 10. Okay, so dia give extra point for wall system. 45, 45, 10 in 2015. And then 2017, dia revise lagi, yang ini dia focus on superstructure stated clearly. Sekarang masih maintain 78-81. Cuma dia ubah pada scoring system dia. 45-45-20, maksimum score dia jadi 110. And in 2017, they introduce for basement. Maksudnya sekarang untuk basement work, substructure work can be considered for Bilibility score or IBS score in Singapore lah. Okay, so dia kena 68 score dia. Minimum. Okay, so that's how Singapore buat. So kat Malaysia ni kita terlalu jump cepat sangat. Sampai 70 lah sekarang. Okay, so kalau you tengok Singapore, dia start daripada awal. So maybe sekarang ni 2020, kalau you tengok the later 2017. Saya tak sempat nak tengok yang latest 2020 ni sama ada dia dah revise a new one or not. Okay, so kalau dah revise a new one, perhaps dah naik lagi lah scoring dia. Okay, so maybe in the future, dalam masa dekat ni dekat Singapore, dia dah tak perlu lagi this minimum BBBG score. Why? Because every project dah use 100% IDS in Singapore. Okay. So, that's all. Any question? Ada soalan? Ya, Faiz. Saya nak tanya. Anyone? Tak ada? Okay.
Kenapa saya tak ada?
Ya, ada yang nak tanya, Faiz?
Tak ada, tak ada.
Tak ada? Okay. Alright, so I believe some of you still might confused lah on how to apply IBS Core, because as I mentioned at the beginning of the lecture today, this is a calculation. Okay, it's not easy to explain to you theoretically. So that's why I allocate one session next week for exercising. Okay, for exercise. Okay, next week we are going to apply what we have learned today lah. So hopefully you will get a better understanding by next week on how to apply the IBS score. Okay, so I'm going to upload the question for next week. I think today I'm going to upload in your future in the same folder, IBS score lecture 7. So maybe you can have a look first, try to apply it first. Alright, so next week kita akan buat sama-sama lah, okay, on the exercise. Alright, if there is no questions, thank you for your time and commitment. Okay, I will see you next week, still using this platform, Google Meet, we're doing exercise. Alright, so that's all for today. Assalamualaikum and thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.